Godot 4.5 is here, and this time it has some incredible new features you won't believe in. So let's take a look at them. To begin with, the Embedded Games tab is now finally available for Mac users. But it also comes with new features. You can now pause the game with the F9 key and advance a single frame with the F10 shortcut to make your debugging sessions much easier. It also has a mute button, as well as a scaling option for when it's embedded. And speaking of debug, you can now mode-select and edit nodes in the remote tab while your game is playing. For FPS games, Godot now offers an out-of-the-box solution to fix weapon clipping. Set your desired Z-clip scale. It already has working shadows, and you can change the model's FOV independently from the camera too. And of course, the much-awaited Stencil shaders are finally here. You can now finally have impossible geometry inside your games. There are some really cool Stencil shaders you can make, including the classic boat shader, portal shader, and per object post effect shaders. They work by using a very simple stencil operation directly in your materials. And there is even a new one-click outline and x-ray options right there in the material options. Selecting one will automatically create and set up an x-pass material with the effect for you. And it's very easy to customize it too. Now, besides that, we also have a lot of quality of life features too. Dragging a node into another will change its selection so you can plug them into the slots. And dragging nodes will also highlight the slots where they can be placed. Some sections now have checkboxes on them to completely disable or enable that feature. Now you can see at a glance which features are enabled. Editor scripts to run your custom scripts are now much better to use. You can right-click the script file and select Run to execute them now. Or you can use the command panel to call the custom scripts from there, as long as they have a class name. Selection now works in any of the two modes above. You can now select objects even if the Move tool or Rotate tool are enabled, which was really annoying not having before. Object selection now shows the active objects in a different color. And local transfer mode now works properly with multiple objects. Duplicating resources is easier now. You can now paste them as unique from the get-go, so you can edit them right away. Then we got some utility features. You can change editor settings per project now by right-clicking and selecting to override the setting to add them to the project setting instead, where they can be changed there. This, however, does not work for theme changes. And along with that, you can also create new project settings in your projects. Just type the name and click the Add button to create a new setting, and they will show up right there. GDScript also had tons of neat features added. It now finally has abstract classes and functions. You just need to add the @AbstractDecorator and it will force inherited types to implement them. And to complete that, now GDScript will autocomplete custom override methods, not only native ones anymore. And speaking of autocomplete, the toolButton decorator will now autocomplete and show the default icons for you right there, which makes creating inspector buttons even more enjoyable. You can print stack trace directly from GDScript by calling printStack. This will also add them to the logs, making finding bugs that much easier. Besides that, color variables will now show its color in the editor, and even let you pick them from the color wheel. Then we got variadic functions, where you can give them any number of parameters. And to prevent future errors, now warning messages will highlight the line besides being hidden at the bottom. And for those who like dynamic typing, variant types now works as export variables, where you can choose what type of variable you want to set in the inspector. Callable autocompletes will no longer create parentheses, which was quite annoying before. Dropping preload resources will now use UIDs to prevent breaking your code when moving files. And resource files now have a refactor duplicate dip function to ensure everything is properly duplicated. And your script member variables now have a blue color to differentiate them from local ones. But besides GDScript, another tool that has some great improvements is the animation player. Before this, you could only move the timeline from the small top section. Now you can double-click anywhere to move it, which feels much better. It also got filters to find your tracks, and alphabetical order sorting. And it can finally mode-select busier handles, a much-needed feature. You can also set the default busier handles in the dropbox below to save you some time while creating new keyframes. The 3D animation also got some nice new features in the form of skeleton modifier 3D nodes. They can be used to constrain multiple bones together, which can help make adjustments and procedural animations. It is also very useful to fix meshes at extreme positions without using blend shapes. Then we got some UI updates. Translating our games has never been easier. You can now quickly switch and preview your translations inside the editor. Just go to View and change it from the Preview Translation menu. and changing the Godot editor language now doesn't require a restart. For control node updates, label text now have stacked effects. You can add multiple outlines and shadows to your texts and make some interesting visuals. Rich text label now have a paragraph separation besides the line spacing, so you can have a better control of how your text looks with just a few changes. And there is now a new foldable container to hide and show your contents when you need them. Then we have the new DPI texture, which can give you dynamic DPI-based resolution for your SVG assets. And it will also make the icons all over Godot sharper due to using them there. Control nodes now have a recursive focus and mouse option to easily adjust your interactions. You can just change the parent node to have it affect all its children. No more having to select each and every one again. Signals now have the option to pass in where they originate from. Just enable advanced options and check in append source. And now the signal source node is added to the callback's last parameter. Then we got some material import improvements. You can now remap the texture color and alpha channels individually. If you ever need an inverted roughness map or just a texture in another color, you can easily change it inside import settings and re-import the asset. And we got an old feature back from Godot 3. You can extract materials from multiple models at the same time, making importing models much faster than before. External materials now will finally use UIDs, so you won't lose them when moving files around. And models now can have a root script, so you won't need to create scenes for simple ones. Just plug in their script, and they are ready. You also got support for bend normals to improve the visuals of your assets, and specular occlusion from ambient light. Then we got some important performance upgrades. Tile maps now chunk collision tiles together, no more creating individual collision blocks for every tile. So games should run faster now for larger maps. And another great improvement comes to the web in the form of SIMD support. This should drastically increase FPS of physics-intensive games on the web, more than doubling the FPS on heavy loads in most cases. And if you want to completely remove shader stutters, you now have the option to enable Shader Baker. This will compile the shader and ship it with your game, meaning you don't have to wait for compiling shaders. It will make your game bigger, but the difference is staggering. And to check how your game is behaving, Godot now has a video run debug tab. It will show you all of the loaded textures and models into the memory, which you can look around. Nav mesh synchronization is now async, meaning it will be that much faster for larger maps, but you might not see much difference for small ones. And finally, some small but important features. You can now check action inputs by event for more control. You can move objects without creating motion vectors by calling reset physics interpolation on that frame. Particle2D now also have some emitter gizmos to see where the spawn zones are. Physics resources now have proper icon colors. Windows builds no longer need a third-party tool to change the icon of your game. Android Godot now has an action touch panel. And Godot now uses SDL3 for joystick input, which should fix a lot of input bugs and add future support for console-specific features. But that's it! A quick overview of some of my favorite Godot 4.5 features. There are still tons of more features not shown here, but I will leave it to you to explore them. I hope you liked this video, and until next time.